why this comeback series, I think, is so important for us. So important for us as individuals and so important for us as a church. When you think about it, what is a comeback? What is a comeback in our lives? I mean, the places that we have been and the things that we've experienced and what we have done, somewhere in your time, somewhere in your life, something has happened to us, right? Something has happened to make us feel embarrassed, to make us feel less. Maybe sometimes we've messed up and we've caused grief or stress or pain. Maybe sometimes, as we're going to talk a lot about today, things happen to us that many times are out of our control, but it brings us to the point of truly rock bottom. But this series is a series that shows us that we can let go of that guilt and that pain that we carry from the past. I mean, how many of us really, and if we're honest with ourselves, if we're honest and do a little self-reflection, if we're honest with ourselves, how many times have we in our life asked ourselves the question, am I really good enough? How many times have we asked ourselves the question, does God really want anything to do with me? If we think back, I bet there's a point where we have said that. I bet there's a point where we've said, I just don't think that I'm good enough. I don't measure up, and I really don't understand why God would want me because of this or because of this decision or because of this circumstance or wherever I was at. You know, we've all had times in our lives when life has beat us down. We've all had times in our lives when we've questioned why something happened to us. Why am I going through this? Why is this happening in my life? I think many times some of us have probably gotten to the point where we've even questioned if we want to go on in our lives. We've made decisions somewhere in our lives that cause us enormous guilt and enormous pain, and many times disappointed ourselves. So throughout this series, we're going to talk about making a comeback. Making a comeback from these situations and being restored through Christ. Because there is restoration, and there is this opportunity to come back no matter where we have been. As it said there at the end, it's never too late. But today I'm going to take us on a little bit of a different path in terms of the comeback. I'm going to take us in a little bit of a different angle. And sometimes things happen to us. Maybe sometimes things are out of our control. And what do we do? What do we do if maybe there really isn't a restoration? What do we do if there really is no way of getting back what we lost? What if there's no way of getting back who we lost? What do we do when we can't come back? What do we do when what is gone is actually gone forever? There are just times in this life where things break and it cannot be fixed. There truly are. Not every story on earth has a happy ending. We don't understand sometimes why God allows grief to come into our lives, but it does and it will. That's why I want you to hear this message so much today, and I hope and I pray that the theme of this message will come across in a way that is helpful. I want you to take the theme of this message, and I want you to hide it. I want you to bury it, as the scripture says. I want you to hide it in your heart and take it with you wherever you go, because we live in a broken world, and there are times that things break, and they just can't be fixed. My theme for the message today is very simple. I think it'll come up here on the screen. It's three words. Jesus is enough. Jesus is enough. If you're looking for a bottom line today, I guess that's pretty much it. It's really simple. But the thing about it is, folks, we live in a broken and sinful world. A world where grief and sadness because of that sin will always, always be present. But there's something else that will always be present as well. Something else that we can count on to always be there to guide us. And that is God's sustaining grace. God's sustaining grace. A day by day, hour by hour, minute by minute, moment by moment, grace that will sustain us through these times. See, here's the thing. God gives you what you need, and what we all need is Him. God gives us what we need, and what we need is Him. Now, this is not a grace that promises that everything will be all right. I think sometimes the world has a little bit of a different view of what Christianity is and what faith in Christ is and what this grace is. I think it's a grace that many times is not totally understood. It doesn't necessarily say that everything is going to be okay. It doesn't offer guarantees except one, and that is that God's grace is always here for us. It's a grace that God gives you when you have nothing left. A grace that is the only hope you have in that particular moment. A grace that says, Jesus is enough. We're going to be in 1 Kings 17 today. If you have your Bibles or your electronic devices, if you want to turn there, kind of get a head start, we're going to start over in chapter 17 of 1 Kings. We're going to be introduced to Elijah today. And some of you may know this story, and you may not, but it's an interesting story. And there's actually two texts that I'm going to use today. And when I was preparing this, I thought, well, I got to make sure that people understand the connection here. But these are two really, I think, really good examples of desperation. And so as we read this text, I want you to think about people being in their most desperate, dire moments in their lives. And that's where these folks are at in these particular stories. We're going to start with Elijah. And Elijah was a prophet, and he's going into the court of King Ahab. And Ahab was a pretty bad dude. I mean, the Bible describes he and a series of other kings at this time of being like each king was getting worse, okay? Like every king got worse and worse and worse. And we get to Ahab, and the Bible, the scripture describes him as being the worst of the lot, all right? He'd been the most evil of all the kings that had come at this time. And what Elijah's going to do is he's going to actually go and he's going to give Ahab some bad news. He's going to tell him that there's going to be a drought, okay? There's going to be a drought in the land, and there's going to be not even rain, but literally no moisture until the time that he comes back and says for it to rain again. Now, you know that old saying, don't shoot the messenger? You guys heard that, right? Well, that didn't apply in this particular situation, okay? So when he goes and tells him, he realizes, hey, he's not going to be happy about this, and he's probably going to try to kill me, right? And so the Lord's looking out for him, and the Lord tells him, you need to leave town. Go and deliver the message, and then you need to get out of town, okay? Because he's going to come after you. And actually, we see in chapter 18 that he had actually, when Elijah leaves, he had actually, Ahab had sent scouts. They had been looking all over the countryside for him when he left. So he was trying to find him to kill him, okay? So that shoot the messenger thing really didn't apply. So what God told him was to go to the wilderness, and he goes to this ravine, and he says, look, you're going to go to this brook, this specific brook that's still going to have water going, all right, while this drought starts. It's going to have water, and it's going to provide you water. And then I'm going to send ravens, and I'm going to bring you meat and bread on a daily basis. So God tells Elijah, says, I'm going to provide for you, both in the natural way and in a supernatural way. I'm going to provide what you need. So a tremendous leap of faith on his part, right? A tremendous leap of faith when he steps out and says, okay, God, I'm going to let you take care of me. This sounds a little strange. Birds going to fly and bring me food. That's okay. I'm good. I got you. And so he steps out in faith. He does what he says, and he goes. And the brook provides water, and the ravens come, and this goes on for a while. But then there wasn't any rain, and so the water is natural. So eventually the brook runs out, and eventually the water runs out, and eventually the ravens will stop coming. And so God's provision now changes, and he gives him a different direction. He tells him to go to a new place, and that he's going to provide for him in a different way. And it's in verse 7 where we pick up our story. You can read along with me here. It says, sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him. Go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink? Simple request, right? Just looking for a little water. But then he goes on. As she was going to get it, he called, and bring me, please, a piece of bread. As surely as the Lord your God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread. Only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. But first, make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make something for yourself and for your son." So think about that. Let's stop here for just a second. Think about that for a second. So this woman, she's this widow. She's at the place. You're in a drought. There's very little water. There's no food. She's on her last bit of provisions. And then this stranger just walks up and says, "Hey, could you give me some water? And while you're at it, could you make me some food?" And he said, and then she says, "Look, I am resigned to the fact I'm going to eat my last meal and die. This is it." She can no longer provide for her family, for her son. She can no longer provide for herself. She's at the point of ultimate desperation. And then what does he do? He says, "That's okay. Just go make me some bread anyway," right? I mean, I can imagine her sitting there thinking, "Buddy, I just told you, this is my last meal. I'm going to die." And he says, "It's okay. Just go make me some bread. Bring it back to me." I just can imagine her sitting there thinking, you know, saying, "Who is this guy?" Right? But then he goes on to say, "For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land." And this is what she did. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. She did it. She gave her last, don't miss this point right here. This is very important. She gave her last bit. She was at the desperate point. This was all she had left. And because she had faith, she said, "I'm going to give you all I have left." And so she does it. And then, so there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. She was at the end of her rope. This was it. She says in the text, "I'm going to go and I'm going to fix this meal and we're going to eat it and we're going to die. That's it. We're done. We're out. This is all I've got." So she's at the point of total desperation. And yet what does she do? She gives what she couldn't give. She couldn't give that away. That was it. But she did it anyway. She gave the last bit of what she had. And you say, "Well, you know, if God was going to save her, you know, he could have just made these huge, you know, storehouses of food appear and do all these things, you know, give her money or whatever, you know, make it rain right on her crops or whatever. I mean, he could have done all these different things." But what he did was something that he always does, and this is this. God looks in the unexpected places for ways to provide grace. God looks in the unexpected places for the ways to provide grace. God doesn't look for the wealth of nations or the overabundance of resources. He was providing for Elijah through a widow and a son who had nothing. They had nothing, and yet they chose to give the last of that nothing to God. There was nothing left. There's another story very similar to this that I think is relevant here. Think about the story with the boy and the loaves and the fishes, right? This is a popular story. We've heard this one before. We've talked about this one before, but let's read it again and look at it from a different situation. In John 6, we read this. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than a half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. the one person in the whole crowd, one little boy had this little basket of food, loaves and fishes. That's all he had. They asked him for it, and what did he do? He could have kept it, right? He could have kept it himself, and he could have ate it, and he could have been fine. But everyone else would have been in desperation. But he gave the last of what he had, a very small amount, a nothing amount, with a task so big. But he gave it to Jesus. He put it in Jesus' hand. And Jesus made more than we could possibly imagine. There's another situation in which Jesus took something that was impossible to fix. He took next to nothing and provided more than what was needed. And you might say to me, well, Chris, these are stories about eating and getting food. You know, what does this really have to do with me? What does this really have to do with helping me understand the loss that I have suffered? Well, I would say that it has everything to do with it. When we lose something so valuable to us that we find it hard even to breathe, when we can't even find breath in our lungs, that's when we're at our most desperate point. That's when we have so little. That's when all we have left is one little bit of flour to make one little piece of bread. We sit at the bottom of a well with no way out. There were 5,000 hungry people with no hope of being fed. There was a widow who was on her last bit of supplies, so much so that she had resigned herself to the fact that she and her son were going to die. But what did they do when they were at the end of their rope? What was their response when they were at the very end? The boy gave all he had and found that he got more than he would ever need. The widow gave away all she had left and ended up with much more than she could possibly imagine. They gave it away. They gave everything that they had left to God. No matter how small, no matter how insignificant, in the face of such a large problem, they gave all of it away. They gave it away when they did not see any possible way that it would fix the situation that they were in. How are those loaves and fishes going to feed so many people? How am I going to make bread for this man? Then we're all just going to die. They didn't see, but they trusted, and they gave everything that they had left. Jesus says in John 6, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This isn't just about food and water. We use those as examples, but it's not just about food and water. It's about the life-sustaining grace that only Jesus can give. Only Jesus can give. And think about this. The math that God uses is totally different. This is where this story goes so counterculture to everything that we live, that we deal with in our lives today. Wherever we're at in our society today, this math goes totally counterculture to everything that we are taught. We're taught in this world to take more, to get more, to try to bring it into ourselves, that we've got to go get and get and get, and that's how we will add up. That's how we'll get more. If we get more, we'll have more. That's the way that our math works in this society, but that's not the way God's math works. God's math works like this. Give away all you have for me and get back more than you will ever need. Give away all you have for me and get back more than you'll ever need. Sounds easy, but it's hard. It's hard, right? I mean, we understand that. We're afraid sometimes to give God everything that we have. If we give him our dreams, maybe those dreams change. Maybe he sends us to a place that we weren't really thinking that we wanted to go. Maybe he sends us to a place Maybe he sends us on the mission field. Maybe he sends us to a different community. Maybe he sends us places that we didn't initially want to go, but we've given our dreams to him. Sometimes it's hard. It's hard to give our tithes sometimes, right? Because we're afraid we don't have enough. So how can we give away and trust? And how hard is it to place that final emotion in his hands? That holding on to that pain and that hurt and that guilt. And I'm afraid that if I give it away, if I give it to Jesus, I'm afraid I won't have anything left to feel in me. And so we hold on to that. We squeeze tighter. I want to hold on to that pain because I feel that. And I'm afraid if I turn that over to Jesus, then it's going to go away and I'm not going to know what to do. We fear that if we give our all to God, that we won't have anything left. But Christ said this, and Eric read this earlier, "For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it." We have the assurance in the scripture that if we give, we're not going to lose anything. Think about the widow. Think about the boy. They gave it away, and they got more than they'll ever need. When we decide to give it away to Christ, when we decide to give that last emotion, we decide to give everything that we have, we're going to get back more than we can possibly imagine. When we get to the bottom, the end of our rope, when we get to the place that there's no hope in our lives, give it all to God. Give God your dreams. Give God your emotions. Give God your intense feelings that you have. When you're at the end and we have nothing left, I love this quote from Louis Giglio. It should come up on the screen. Give God your little and see what he does with it. Give God your little and see what he does with it. Because there's nothing that he can't do. There's another quote from the book that I wanted to share with you, and it says this: "When Jesus is enough, we focus on what we have, not on what we don't, and not on what we may lose." When Jesus is enough, we focus on what we have, not on what we don't. We may not understand the way God works in this world. We don't understand the pain, the grief, the loss. And we're going to lose things in this life that there's just times that we're just not going to get it back. But when our lives are at the point that there is nothing left, that's when we can reach out to God and know that he is there. And know that Jesus is enough. Let's pray.